You're in the Spotlight with Teresa Hand, and I'm just so happy that you have joined me. Love you, love you, love you. Hey, I've got something special. It's a special surprise just for you. You're going to love this show with my special guest. I want to start by saying a Bible verse that is dear to his heart and now dear to my heart, 2 Kings 3:15. Now listen, but now bring me a minstrel. And it came to pass, when the minstrel played, that the hand of the Lord came upon him. I think you know who I'm talking about, but let me go on a little bit further. Since he came on the national scene in 1990, there have been many titles associated with my special guest in the spotlight today. They have called him, number one, the Quincy Jones of gospel to the father of gospel jazz. Now, I know you know who I'm talking about. My guest in the spotlight is our own modern-day David, the minstrel himself, Ben Tanker. But before you hear his wonderful voice, I want you to get ready to get your praise on with Ben Tanker right now.
Well, I woke up this morning with my eyes stayed on Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Get on up out of your seat. Clap your hands. Stomp your feet. The Lord's been good to you. You need to let him know you love him too. Get on up, yeah.
Get your praise on.
Get your praise on.
Get on up and get your praise on.
Get your praise on.
Get your praise on. God's been good to you. Get your praise on.
If you can't sing, you might try to dance. You got a lot to shout about. When things go up, blessings come down. All you need is breath to praise the Lord. Get on up, y'all.
Get your praise on.
Get your praise on.
Get on up and get your praise.
Oh, you better pay me.
Welcome. You're in the spotlight with Teresa Hannah, and I'm excited. You just got your praise on with Ben Hankert. Now meet him in person with me right here in the studio. Ben Hankert, welcome to In the Spotlight with Teresa Hannah.
Hey, Miss Teresa, I am so glad to be here with you. Thank you guys for having me. Are you having a great day today?
Well, I'm having a wonderful day, and I know that our listening audience is having a wonderful day now since you've got so many fans out there who love your music. I tell you what, I would like to begin with this, and this is a quote that you said, and it is just so profound. I want to share it with our audience, and I want you to comment later, but you have been called, of course, the Quincy Jones of gospel and the father of gospel jazz. And you kind of explained it thus, and this is what you said, and I quote, Technically, the music is the same. A Christian C note sounds the same as a non-Christian note. But as a minister, God releases his spirit and power through me, and the music becomes a vehicle of salvation to carry God's love, healing, and deliverance. This statement from you is just so definitive of the man of God that you are, whereby I know that the Holy Spirit resides. So I kind of want you to just comment on your statement.
Well, I like to say this. Guns don't kill people. People kill people.
That's right.
And so
right.
The guns in the wrong hands becomes totally different in no use. A gun in the right hand is you can hunt for food for your family. A gun in the wrong hands, you become a criminal. So same thing with music. The music is the same. God created music. You know, you remember Job was complaining. You can go to the book of Job and, you know, he had a tough time, lost all his wealth, lost his family,
yes,
his children, his barns and everything. So people were coming to him saying, hey, you know, you lost everything. What are you going to do? So he started cursing everything. He cursed the day that he was born. He cursed the day that the sun came up. You know, cursed be
Sounds
the day.
Sounds like a black man to me.
he's like, cursed be the day that my mama gave my daddy her bone number. He was cursing everything. And so God said, hey, listen, where were you when I framed the
That's
foundations
right.
of the universe as
right.
the morning stars sang?
So
that
yes.
indicates to me that music was present during creation. You know, so there was a backdrop of music that was playing while God made the universe. So the music was here before the universe was here. The music was here before radio, before instruments. So there's no such thing as secular music. There are secular people, secular thoughts, but the music belongs to God. I'm just the repo man, and I'm here to repossess what was God from the get-go. So what I did was God gave me this gift to play, and it's a jazzy style, so I decided just to coin it as gospel jazz. Jazz is the vehicle, but the gospel is the passenger.
I'll sum it up by saying, done real good, Pastor. You know, it's just so very exciting that God has used your ministry where actually people are getting healed. Can you share a little bit about that aspect of your ministry?
Well, you know, when you talk to people and people feel better after you said something positive to them, there wasn't a shot that was taken, there wasn't an operation. They were just discouraged. And you said, you know something, Teresa, things are going to get better. Be encouraged.
Yeah.
It's going to get better. The fact that you spoke those words transferred an emotion to that person, and they began to feel better based on the words that you spoke. So in those words was a spirit of encouragement. But just like that works in words, it works 100 times better in music because there's not a language barrier. So if you can ever capture or harness that power of music and release it properly, you can put healing in it, you can put encouragement, empowerment in it. And that's what happened when David came before a king that was had an evil spirit, and David played. They called for the messenger, and he played. He didn't have to say nothing. He just played. That evil spirit left off of that person. So God kind of gave me that same gifting when I play. I've seen people get out of wheelchairs. I've seen people leave. I've seen people come to my concert and say, this is the last concert I'm coming to. After we leave here, we're going to go get a divorce. And I've seen people come to the concert and leave all hugged up and say, we're going to go home and make this marriage work.
All right. Praise God.
I've seen people come and say, listen, when I leave here, I'm going to blow my brains out. I'm going to commit suicide. But after the concert, they decided to go ahead and live and keep living. And I didn't talk to them. I just shared the music, and it was the victory that God put in the music.
Praise God. Wonderfully said. And on that note, you are listening to Ben Tankard. He's in the spotlight with me, Teresa Hannah, and we're getting ready to go to another song. This is a good place right here to put Ben. The song is called Love Makes Me an Instrument from Your Keys of Life. This is Ben Tankard.
Instrument.
Back in the spotlight with Teresa Hannah and Ben Tanker, and the song you just heard, Love Makes Me an Instrument, from Keys to Life, 1991, featured Take Six. Beautiful, beautiful song. Ben, I'm just your fan of everything you just about done. I've got my favorites, though, and I think these are them that I'm playing. But let's go back to the past. You are a professional basketball player. Kind of share that story with us a little bit.
Well, the basketball thing didn't last too long, T. I was born and raised in poverty, 6 foot six by the time I was in the sixth grade. So basketball was sort of the default mode that you defaulted to when you're 6 foot six and you're black and poor in a neighborhood. You know, everyone is saying, hey, you're black, you're tall, you're poor, play ball. You know? and so I defaulted to that. And it was a lofty goal, not a bad goal, but it wasn't what God wanted me to do. I always was a musician growing up. I was a tuba player in the band, you know, play drums as from a kid. So when I got ready to graduate from high school, I had 30 scholarship offers for band and also 30 scholarship offers for basketball. And so I could have took the
even
band scholarship.
Even season, yeah.
You know, I wanted to take the band scholarship because I really love the music, but my dad said, son, you know, you're a tuba player. Who's going to call you in the studio to cut tuba tracks on their album? you're going to starve as a tuba player, you know. So I went the basketball route. It was secondary in my heart, but it was primary in our thinking as to what I was going to be able to make money from. So I took a basketball scholarship, dropped out of college after just 1 year, and went pro to the minor league, went to Canadian basketball. And then I got an invite to come to the Portland Trailblazers. And so if I can just get through this camp, this combine camp, they call it, and impress the coaches, I can keep my contract and my invite to be with the Portland Trailblazers. And I'd be the guy that would be coming off the bench as a reserve behind Clyde the Glide Drexler. You know, I would be a shooting guard. But I got injured in that combine. So I was on the team, but then I was off the team. Cut. Because there were many other players that were healthy that could walk on and try out and be ready to play. Here I am injured. I wasn't drafted. I pretty much was a walk-on. I was just lucky to be there. And so because of that injury, that caused me to be able to be sent home. And so that is when I got sent home. That's when I was reintroduced to God. I was raised a preacher's kid, but I didn't really pay any attention to God. But now here I am depressed and no money and no contract and no education. Now I'm ready to get serious about God. So I went to church and God saved me for real. And I was anointed to play the keyboard in this very same service and began to play but just like a professional jazz musician when I put my hands on the keys. So the basketball came first, but it was very, very short-lived. And that was my introduction into the gospel music industry, where there was a death of my basketball, there was a birth of the music career.
Amen, amen. And you were actually going into the field that the Lord would have you to go into. You know, God has a way of putting us where He needs us to be. I kind of recall when I was in college, I had made up my mind then that I was going to be a dietitian. And that's all I talked about, you know, in high school. And when I got to Tennessee State University and was getting ready to register, they had these lines set up in the gym and with all the various curriculum. And the Lord pointed that to a sign that said speech and drama. I thought, oh, no, I want to stay in this under this sign that says foods and nutrition. Lord said, no, you're going to get out and you're going to go. And I tell you, it was like something just literally pushed me over in the speech and drama line. So God has a way of making you're supposed to do, and this you have done for Him, and we're so proud of you. And that, you know, that just brings us up to you have enjoyed God's blessings in this. This has been an illustrious career for you. I'm so proud of you. Just so much. You've accomplished so much, and you've been so blessed. I wanted to ask you personally if you would just highlight some of the most meaningful events of your gospel music career and in your various roles.
Well, you know, just when you think there's a bucket list thing that, you know, you figure once God does this, I'm gonna sit my behind down somewhere and just be satisfied. But whenever God does something, He gets bored and He says, "All right, then I've accomplished that in your life. I'm bored. What's next?" So when He asks you what's next, it really makes you get up versus when you're asking God what's next.
Oh yeah.
And you know, so 15 gold, 6 platinum recordings. 18 Stellar Awards, 3 Grammy, 3 Grammy nominations, 8 Dove nominations. Just recently inducted into the Stellar Awards Gospel Music Hall of Fame.
Congratulations! Wonderful.
You know, and to be honored by your peers like that is just so joyous, because the people that you labor with for 30 years pat you on the back and say, "Hey, we might not have always said it, but we're saying it tonight. You've done good and we appreciate you." It feels really good. So I've had a lot of success. You know, I minister over 100 concerts a year. I pastor a church. I've got a great wife and family. I've got homes in 3 states. You know, I've got a home in Destin, a home in Atlanta, a home in Nashville. I got more cars than I can drive. I got more bedrooms than children, and I got 2 airplanes. I am happier than a witch and a broom. I'm more happy than a witch in a broom factory with a 90% off coupon.
Amen. You know, you just mentioned something that's coming up next on my itinerary to ask you, and that is the love of your life, Jewel LaGreen Tanker. You're right. How has she influenced your life, career, and ministry?
She is indeed what I call a king maker. You know, if for all the brothers that are listening, and if you're not married yet, let me tell you something. A woman is going to either be a king maker or a king breaker. It ain't going to be nothing in between. She's going to make you or break you. So I had a couple breakers in my life, but God helped me get it right this time. And Jewel has really made me, because what happened is when we got together, she is a true helpmeet. She saw things in me that I didn't even see in myself, and she helped me achieve those goals, and she helped jerk the slack out of me, and we make each other better. You know, she's not just some doormat that's hopping on one foot like the girl from Coming to America, but she is actually one that is a partner in everything that I do. And she keeps me inspired, and she keeps me in check too. When I start slipping or getting lazy, she'll say, "Honey, come on now. God is not done with you. You can do this. You can do this."
Wow. Okay.
So she is a super, super blessing.
Amen. We want to give some applause for the jewel in your life, your queen. LaGreen Tanker. That's magnificent. And especially, you know, hearing it from your husband. Oh, what a blessing. What a blessing. And what a wonderful woman you have just shared with us talking about. Tell us a little bit more about your family, your kids, and, you know, things about the family.
many of your viewers probably already know my family, because we have a very, very successful and popular reality show that we've been involved with for the last 3 seasons. We're getting ready to start season 4. It was formerly called Thicker Than Water, The Tankards, on the Bravo network. We're expanding past Bravo into several other syndications, so we won't be on Bravo, but we'll be on even a higher level in terms of people seeing us on television. We'll be in more places and past just cable TV, and the show will now be called The Tankards, and we're working on season 4 right now. But I've got 5 children, I've got 5 grandchildren, And my children are grown, but not necessarily gone. So depending on what week it is, people say, "Well, do your kids live with you?" I'm saying, "I don't know what week is it, you know, because sometimes they're here, sometimes they're not, you know." But I love them all, and we try to help them achieve their own goals. Half of them are married and have kids. The other half are still trying to figure it out and believe God for their mates and everything. But it's all good. And we're just happy that Jewel and I can be a resource. We have a blended family, you know, and so when you look at our family.
How you guys successfully, or how did you successfully maneuver a blended family life?
It's like a Black Brady Bunch. And I think when we got together, what we did was throw out the rule book, because there is no rule book that works for everybody as to how to manage a blended family, because every person is different. So you can't just get a book off the shelf and say, "All right, we're going to do it this way," because, you know, those kids, they ain't never seen this other parent before. So, you know, we decided we weren't going to have no steps, no stepmama, no stepdaddy, stepmama, daddy, you know, because I didn't want to hear all that. "You ain't none of my mama. You ain't none of my daddy. You ain't going to tell me what to do." No, if you eating off this table, I'm your daddy.
That's right.
If you eating off this table, that's your mama. So we had to cut all those old step rules, and we're all just one big happy family. And another thing, Teresa, in terms of, let me encourage some of our listeners, what hurts the children the most is to see parents and their other parents going at it all the time.
Let it go.
We had to forgive our exes. We had to develop working relationship with our exes, so that when the kids come over, I had to stop saying stuff like, how your crazy mama doing? You know, you don't talk like that. You know, and so even though the kids at a young age sometimes would tell me what I thought I wanted to hear and say, "Daddy, am I crazy? You want to know what my crazy mama did?" Even though they would participate with it, they would still end up feeling hurt when I said something negative about their mom, because that mom is part of them. So once
they
stop
love
doing
their
that,
mama.
Yeah, so once we stop going after the exes and speaking negative, and Jules stopped saying negative things about her daughter's father who's absentee, who hadn't paid child support, whatever. Once we stop all that foolishness, God will really begin to bless us beyond what we could dream. So now we just big, rich family with money to spend, vacations to go on, and do stuff and be a blessing to our kids even at a higher level, because God has blessed us materially because we took our mouths off of our exes and put it on our children.
Good advice. It's just, how the Lord has blessed you. And I thank God for it. I want to go ahead and do another song right here. And the song is called Hold On, Keep Strong. Will you introduce it for me, Ben?
Yeah, you know, all of us face challenges in our life. Even the Bible says that in this life you shall have tribulation. Tribulation means something that's unexpected, unpleasant, change of circumstances. It's kind of like turbulence when you're flying an airplane. It's unexpected, unpleasant, change of circumstance. But just hold your course, because you're going to end up landing and it's going to be all good. So hold on, keep strong means that no matter what you're going through, just hang on to God's unchanging hand, like the old school used to say, because he's coming through in the end.
All right, amen. And the Spotlight with Teresa Hanna, this is Ben Tankard. Hold on, keep strong. Spotlight with Teresa Hannah, and I have in the spotlight with me Ben Tanker, and you just heard the song Hold On and Keep Strong. I think that was from your Mercy CD. But I thank you so much, Ben, for being with us. Love the song, love you. I want to go back to that Bigger Than Water, the Tankers, the show that began on Bravo. Please tell us how the show began and how it was used as an instrument for ministry.
Well, you know what I say all the time is just be yourself, because everybody else is already taken. And that's how we got our reality show. We was just being ourselves. It was so funny. I was taking my iPhone and posting comical clips on YouTube of just the crazy things that happened in my household. You know, like one time my daughter Brooklyn was in the kitchen. You know, she's in college at the time, but she was in the kitchen cooking. And, you know, Brooklyn ain't the kind that get up and do her hair to go in the kitchen. She just get up and just, you know, wash her face, brush her teeth, and then she just straight, you know, kitchen's in her head while she in the kitchen. So I took the phone into the kitchen and I started recording. I went snuck up behind her. I started recording the back of her hair that had all these nasty kitchens, and while she's in the kitchen cooking. And I said to the phone, I said, "This, the name of this episode is Kitchens in the Kitchen." And the little clip went viral of me recording Brooklyn's kitchens in the kitchen. And my daughter, Cyrene and Brittany, they started singing. They made a song out of it called Kitchens in the Kitchen, Kitchens in the Kitchen. And the song, I mean, the little video is still on YouTube today. And it just went viral. People started commenting on it. And Universal, NBC, Bravo heard about it, saw it, and contacted us over a YouTube post.
Wow.
I said, would you guys like to continue doing stuff like that every week on TV? And, you know, of course, my wife has this spiritual answer when you ask, you know, why would you expose your family to the world like this? Why would you want to do a reality show that shows your family? Why did you just agree to do this show and have 3 or 4 million people looking at you every week? You know, why would you do that? And my wife has this spiritual answer. Oh, we just wanted to be a blessing. People don't do what you say. People do what you do. So it's a ministry opportunity, and we just want to be a blessing and a beacon of light in a dark world. We just want to hold the bloodstain.
Yes.
She got this Christian answer, but I'm like, that's her. When they ask me why did I do a reality show, my answer, T, you know, you've been knowing me for 30 years. I'm real than real. I say, listen, I was going to be myself anyway. I might as well get a check.
That's right.
I was going to beat myself anyway. I might as well get a check for it. That's why I did it.
That's you.
Now, be for real, Teresa Hannah. If somebody knocked on your door tomorrow and showed up with some cameras and said, listen, Teresa, we want to follow you, and we want you to just be yourself, and we're going to pay you thousands of dollars for you to be yourself.
Yes.
Wouldn't you want to be yourself?
Yes, I do want to
be myself.
I guess
you
talk to my Lord, too. Talk about my
needs. And you wouldn't need not one scripture to justify it. Just be yourself.
That's right. That's easy enough. That is easy enough. That was fun. But you guys have also transitioned into another area of the ministry. You have the Destiny Center in Murfreesboro, Tennessee. Wonderful ministry. Of course, you are the pastor, and Jewel is your first lady. Tell us a little bit about your ministry.
It is a church, but we really didn't really advertise it as a church when we started. You know, it's called Destiny Center. So when you hear the word Destiny Center, you don't really know it's a church. You know, Destiny Center is just what it says. You know, it's a center for destiny. You know, so we started as a Bible study in the home, really. You know, because I got this big mansion in Murfreesboro, Tennessee. Not that many black people live in Murfreesboro that have a mansion, that fly their own airplane. So I was getting stopped a lot by brothers and sisters that were saying, hey, who are you? Who are you? And what do you do? And how do you do it? So I said, you know something? Let me just introduce you to the guy that gave me all this. Come over to the house on Thursday night, and we're going to have an entrepreneur's Bible study. I'm just going to show you some scriptures. Let me introduce you to the guy that gave me all this, which was, of course, God. That Bible study turned into 50, 60 people in our living room. Mm-hmm. And my wife said, honey, this ain't no Bible study. This is a church.
This is a church.
And I said, okay, baby, what do you mean? She said, well, honey, there's too many people using my bathroom. She said, is it okay if you and Jesus get y'all own building? So she kicked me and Jesus out the house, and we had to rent a building, and that was 15 years ago, and now we're on the third building of Destiny Center.
Oh, praise God. How wonderful that is.
So that's my Destiny Center story. You know, we're not under any particular denomination. You know, we fellowship really close with Creflo Dollar and Joel Osteen and people like that, but we're not part of a denomination. I can't be fired because I don't work for a salary anyway. I bought the building. It's my name on the church mortgage. So if the people don't give an offering, if they don't pay, I have to pay. If the people don't come, I'll turn it into a skating rink.
All right.
But we've been so relaxed in ministry because we didn't have to try to build it to develop our own lifestyle. You know, many ministers want a big church because it'll mean they get to have a prosperity lifestyle from it. You know, cars and houses and clothes. I had that before we started the church, so that's not my goal.
My goal is just to duplicate
myself in the community. I want to see more Ben Tankards and more Jewel Tankards growing up in Murfreesboro. What I mean by that was people who know who they are, and people who are rich in every area of their gift, not necessarily a gold artist or a platinum musician or a businesswoman, but whatever God has called them to do. I believe that we're anointed to help you find that destiny for you. That's why we call it Destiny Center.
Amen. Amen. Beautiful. Beautiful. Destiny. So where is it located in Murfreesboro?
We're on the main drag in Murfreesboro, 1510 Memorial Boulevard, main drag in Murfreesboro, Tennessee, middle of town, main drag. And our services are 10:30 on Sunday morning, and we'll get you out like the white folks. We'll have you out by noon. We don't kick you all day. Pharaoh, let my people go.
what is the web address for those that may be listening and say, well, I'm going to just prepare a trip, and when I'm in Tennessee, I'm going to go down to Murfreesboro and visit the
Destiny Center. They can just hit the bentankard.org or jeweltankard.org or the Destiny Dome. .tv, the DestinyDome.tv, and all of our social media is our names, at Ben Tankard or at Jewel Tankard, on all of the social media platforms, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, all this stuff, at Ben Tankard or at Jewel Tankard.
All right. Okay. Hey, you have a competitive edge. You're competitive. How has this competitive personality helped you in your success as an artist, as a producer, as a television personality, and as a musician? Tell us about the competitive Ben Tankard that I know so well.
Well, that's such a great question, Teresa, because many times people are competitive and it gets them out of the game. Because guess what? there's always going to be somebody else that's mm-hmm. doing better, that's doing better than you.
That's right.
So you don't use what's happening in other people's life. You use what's happening in other people's life to inspire you, not retire you. What I mean by that is, you know, if you got a church that's got, like myself, we got a church that's got, you know, less than 500 people. One of my best friends is Joel Osteen. I've been working with him for 8 years on tour with him at his Night of Hope. Mm-hmm. He's got 20,000 people that shows up at his event live. And then he's got 50,000 people that shows up every weekend over the weekend for his multiple services in Houston. So here I am, me and Joel. He's only a couple years older than me. But if I look at what he's doing and compare the wrong way, I'll be discouraged and say, let me give up. What am I doing? I'm over in Murfreesboro. I only have 500 people. Here's Joel Osteen, a couple years older than me. He's got 50,000 people. So I don't compare from the standpoint of what I'm doing versus what he's doing. My comparison is, am I better? Am I better at what I do since I've been his friend? That's how you compare it. Is my life better now since when I met him and the things I've learned from him? So when you get ready to listen to gospel jazz, you can't pick up a Joel Osteen CD, but you can pick up a Ben Tankard CD.
That's right.
So when you get ready to go to a basketball arena for a church service, you know, and see 20,000 people, you know, you come to my church, you're going to see 200 or 300 people. That's it. But you go to Joel's, folks, you're going to see 20,000. So everybody has their gifting, but it doesn't mean that what somebody else is doing is wrong. It's God calls us all to do different things, and you just have to be happy with what he's giving you. And that's what being walking in your destiny is, accepting what you are, but also accepting what you are not. Because if you don't know what you are not, you will be unhappy until you achieve what you are not, and you're not going to ever be what you are not.
Wisdom. Well said, Pastor. Wisdom. Wisdom. I wanted to ask you, too, because I know that we're moving very quickly. Our time is getting low, but I've got to ask you this because this is a passion for you, and I wouldn't feel like your sister if I didn't. How do you fulfill your calling in the empowerment of others? That word means so much to you, giving back.
You know what helped me really look at that from a standpoint that motivates me, Teresa, is, you know, I'm a pilot. You know, I fly my own airplane. And so when I started taking lessons 20 years ago, they didn't just put me in the airplane and give me the keys and say, learn it. You don't want to do that. I had to go to ground school first. Ground school means you have to learn some things on the ground and get grounded before you get up in the air. And one of the things that they taught us first was the laws of flight. The four laws of flight are lift, thrust, weight, and drag. Right. And we learned that before we started even flying and getting high in the airplane. So that also applies to life, not just flying an airplane. So everything in your life is going to be lift, thrust, weight, or drag. Every friend that you have is either going to be a lifter, a thruster, a weight on your relationship, or a drag. Just think about it. Your car, you know, your car payment, your house payment, everything in your life is going to come in one of those four forms. It's either going to be lift for you, a thrust, a weight on you, or a drag to you. And so my ministry is based on everything I do, whether it's speaking, performing music, doing reality TV, writing books, or whatever. Everything I do is geared around providing lift and thrust for other people. I want to stay away from being a weight or a drag. I want to be a lift and a thrust for God's people.
Amen. I'm going to adopt that. Lift, thrust, weight, drag. I like that. Applying that to my life. Everybody, we need to apply that to our lives today. Ben, this has been fantastic. I've enjoyed you. I've learned so much. I have been excited. inspired. I just want to say thank you so much again. Before we go, though, I want you to tell us, give us your contact information. If there may be people who want you to come and do a concert for them, or they may want to know how to get your music. You know, you have a you have a new CD, Full Tank Volume 3. I want you to also tell us about that.
Well, all of the music and my new book, The Full Tank Life, and Volumes 1, 2, and 3 of the Full Tank CD series, all of that can be purchased from Amazon, iTunes, Barnes & Noble, or Walmart online. Or if you go into the stores, we're in the same bookstores that you would find Joel Osteen, because we're on the same publisher as Brother Joel. So we're out there. You can just Google my name for more information. Ben Tankard, just Google my name, or go to Wikipedia. And at Ben Tankard is our social media handles. If you would like to send us a personal email for an invitation for an event, it's very simple. Ben Tankard at AOL.com or BenTankard at Comcast.net.
All right. Excellent. Is there anything else that we have to look forward to coming from the Tankards?
Well, be on the lookout for the Tankards Season 4 coming this winter onto a television station near you. And also, I want to encourage everyone to make sure that you have continued to pray for your country. Pray for your country. Pray for the United States. You might not agree with who's in office, but it's who we have for now. So let's just pray that God provides sanity in the White House, some wisdom and instruction for their mind. You know, sitting around waiting for the government or the president to fail is like almost like flying in an airplane and you don't like the pilot. And you want the plane to go down because you don't like the pilot. Well, if you're on the plane, you know, let's kind of help that pilot tell you at least.
Yeah, we're gonna have you. Gonna have you see there. Pass our coffee.
I am not knocking. I'm not knocking that pilot in the head till we get to the ground. Come on now.
There you go. 4 years up. Thank you so much for your wisdom, Ben, and your humor. I have enjoyed this interview, and I know that our audience have too. And audience, you have definitely been in the spotlight today with a master artist, Ben Tankard. I am just so glad that you came in to do this interview with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you for the invite, and we look forward to chatting with you guys very, very soon.
I can't wait. We'll just have to come back and talk about that book. Thank you so much, Ben. God bless you. God bless you real good.
Okay, dear. We'll talk to you soon. Take care. Let me know about May 19th.
All right. Bye-bye.
All right. Take care now. We'll be right back.
Jordan.